Hi, welcome back to my channel. My name is Rachel. That is the R in the RK Stumbling Bear, and I am a reader and a writer. And this has been a very busy week. It's gardening season, so someone has decided that I must help in the garden, even though that's not my thing. So it has limited my reading time and my time to do any activities that I want to do. So I only finished one thing this week, and that was The Alchemy of Sorrow. The editors are Sarah Chorn and Virginia McLean. This is a short story collection, fantasy and sci-fi, more fantasy than I found, that these stories revolve around grief and hope, and they're supposed to have both in them. So there's 13 stories. I'm just going to go over my top three, I guess, first to say. This collection made me cry so many times. It has been a while since stories have made me cry, so definitely some very poignant stories in here. But my favorite one was Skies on Fire by Sonia M. Black. And then this is about a woman who has to retire due to chronic illness. Her body's broken, and she doesn't really want to retire because she doesn't know what she's going to do. She thought she would die being a phoenix fighter. And so it's her coming to terms with that and realizing that life does go on and you can do things afterwards. And maybe it's because my parents have hit the retirement age and retirement doesn't seem so far away for me now. I don't actually think I'll ever will retire. So I kind of had the same mindset. So what happened if my body forced me to? Like, I could not go continue to work. I imagine that I would kind of go through the same experience as this character. My second favorite was Death in the Uncanny Valley by M.L. Wing, and this is dealing with loss of a parent. Mom has recently died due to a terminal illness, and Mom had full custody of son and daughter. Now, daughter's a teenager, and so daughter now has been sent to live with her dad, who doesn't know what to do. Son, while Mom was sick, with Mom's blessing, has gone on this journey to Mars, and his dad reaches out because he's needing help. Cassie, the sister, she has, since the funeral, has gone into an MMO virtual reality game and will not come out except for like quick things, and is not communicating with her dad at all. Granted, they don't have a good relationship because of other things. But Sam, the older brother, when dad reaches out, he's like, you always want something. What's going on? And dad points out, it's not just her mom she's grieving and missing. It's you as well. It's like, I realize that I've been a shitty dad, but help me be better because she deserves better. And so Sam reaches out to a friend, gets some VR goggles, and goes into the game. And it's just the realization that sometimes we have to take opportunities, and the opportunities are really to teach us that what we left behind was what was most important for us to be, but because we were blinded by lights and shiny new things that are out there to do, we don't always see what we have. And also that relationships change and form. Sam has way more resentment against their dad than Cassie does, but Sam was older when his dad left. And again, the reasons why, or what was going on when dad left. But Sam also recognizes that Cassie can have a different relationship with her dad. And she deserves to have a parent who cares, that is present. And that kind of changes how he wants to work with his father. Very interesting story. And I like the VR experience. And then my third favorite is A Matter of Trust by Angela Bord, and I've just blanked on the story. Editor here. As happens. Sometimes you forget details. And then once you finish filming, you remember the story. So in A Matter of Trust, this is about a young man, young to, I'd say, late 20s maybe, who has a wife and a baby, and he's a gambler, and he's just not wanting to change his ways, so his wife kicks him out. Then it jumps forward in time, and he's now working as a sellsword, and his current mission is helping take a noblewoman and her very little kids back to her spouse. She's been living not in exile, but she's been living in another country for safety reasons because some wars had broken out in her country. He's worked with one of the men before because he's a sellsword for this lord of the lady. But all the other people who are helping have been hired to go on this journey, and there had been some issues with hiring people. And so he doesn't trust him, but he realizes, like, he's basically the new guy as well, so he knows he doesn't get a lot of trust. And he started a friendship with the young children and the noblewoman. And he's still coming to terms with, I've lost my wife. He's, trying to write to her to say, look, this is how I'm changing. And during the story, he has to learn that, you know what? That time has gone, and your wife had to make other decisions to take care of her and your child. So what is the best thing for you to do? And at the beginning, you see him writing to his wife, and then at the end, he writes a letter to his son, and then just says, you know what? I know you have a stepdad. I hope that he is teaching you everything that I couldn't, but I am also here for you. Just seeing that evolution of him realizing that I'm not going to get my wife back. She's moved on. But I still can build a relationship with my child. And I can still build a relationship with other people. I can still change as a person. Editor out. This collection gave me a lot of new authors to look at. Now your challenge to go find this collection and read it. Then, this week, I made progress on Tress of the Emerald Sea by Brandon Sanderson. This is such a sweet, heartwarming story of where Tress has fallen in love with Charlie, and Charlie's parents take him off the island to go find a bride, but Charlie's promised that he's going to come back and marry her, and then she finds out Charlie has been captured by the sorceress of the Midnight Sea and decides to go save him because nobody else is going to. So she's on her journey right now, and just, I love it. And I like how things are stacking upon one another. This is a great example of the characters making choices, and that affects what is going on in the story. And yeah, there's other things happening in the background that she doesn't realize always right away, but she is an active participant, and I love those type of stories. Not always a fan of Brandon Sanderson's writing, but this one he is nailing for me. I am also working on The Goblet of Fire by J.K. Rowling. Blank the author. A reread. I'm about 40% in, and I'm a little bored actually with this. Just the whole setup. And I think this was my issue the first time I read it as well. The setup of, you have this contest going on, and of course you have to be a certain age to enter, and lo and behold, Harry's name has been entered. And for me, I was like, it feels very formulaic, which I know middle grade has it follows that formula, it's part of the structure. But I think I was hitting that age where I was like, okay, eh. And in this one, this is always the book I say where the tone and the direction the books went in are very different than what my heart told me they were supposed to go in, if that makes any sense. Often I think of the first three books and be like, yeah, that's it. It's just the first three. She never wrote any more. Just because this one is very much a tonal shift. I know other people love this book, But besides the beginning part where we, with the Quidditch match, I loved that. Sad we didn't get to actually see the whole thing in the movie. But when we got to the contest, I felt like it was just pulling away from the story, I guess. We went back to, oh, everybody either loves Harry Potter or they hate him, which they've done in the past two books. And I'm like, okay, this is getting old. Having an entire school love you or an entire school hate you, too much. So, reading slowly. I have also picked up Night Music by Tobias Cabrel, and this is one of our self-published science fiction contest finalists. And just slowly reading it because it's an ebook. And I've been having to share my phone with my husband, which is how I read my ebook stuff. And I wasn't quite sure how music was gonna kinda play into this, because it started off with Seth listening to classical music as he's out in space doing an exercise. And then I've gotten to the part where I found out his mom was a cellist. I'm like, oh, that makes sense. A lot of my favorite types of music are things that I grew up listening to from my parents. And, since growing up, I've expanded things, but a lot of my favorites are still those first things that I grew up listening to. For my two readathons, I have not started anything yet. Now that The Alchemy of Sorrow is done, I'm going to be picking up Human Beasts and Ghosts because this is a series of essays, so slow reading. For the Chaos Queens readathon, I have started my deep clean. I started the month of May with over 500 emails, and I have gotten down to 400, and I'm working on decreasing that to zero. Basically, just what I need. So, I'm doing a digital clean there. For my writing wrap up, experiencing the world, getting ideas, because again, someone thinks that it's gardening season, and that requires both of us. For other media, I have started a rewatch of Elementary, which is found on Hulu. It's the modern version of Sherlock Holmes, which has Joan Watson played by Lucy Liu. And I've started at the beginning, and then I hope to finish it just to kind of see if it holds up. The first episodes have for me, so I'm looking forward to it. And that has been my weekly wrap up. I don't have anything promised coming up. Sorry. I hope you guys have a good weekend. Thank you and have a great day.